We just want to give you a quick update about our family and our ministry here in Vail. We appreciate your prayers and support for our family and ministry. God has blessed us in a great way, and when we originally came to the United Kingdom, our goal was to help reestablish a church that was about to close. This past March, God led us to Barry, Wales, where we've been working with Princess Street Evangelical Baptist Church.
Barry is a coastal town of 51,000 people that sits 7 miles southwest of Cardiff, the capital of Wales. It is a growing community with many houses being built and new families moving into the area. Barry, along with much of South Wales, was greatly impacted during the Welsh Revival, but many of those churches have since closed.
Princess Street Evangelical Baptist Church was once a thriving church just about 40 to 50 years ago. But over the years, the attendance continued to drop, and they were about to close the doors just a couple years ago. We are grateful for how God has brought us into contact with the church and what He is doing here in the community. The church building is located in a great location surrounded by hundreds of homes, which gives us an incredible opportunity for outreach. We have been amazed to see all that God has done here in the community and in the church over the last couple months. This past summer, four young ladies made a profession of faith. The Mums and Tots group has continued to grow and has doubled in size. A couple of those mothers have been coming to the church over the last few weeks and have continued to show interest about spiritual things. The youth club has continued to grow with many new young people coming, and we've been studying creation over the last month. They have been asking many great questions about God, about the Bible, about creation, and we are grateful for our time that we can answer those questions from the Word of God. Please pray that God would give us wisdom as we minister to many new individuals that have been attending the church. Pray that God would bring them to the next step in their spiritual life, whether it's salvation or whether it's growth in their spiritual walk with Christ. We appreciate your many prayers for us, and it is because of you that we were able to minister here in the United Kingdom.
Their kids program. The video didn't reflect it, but every time they post something on Facebook about that TOPS program, they're just slam packed full of kids. So I think it's safe to say that they are having quite an influence in the United Kingdom. And as I said, they were the first ones to respond to me. Right back with it. And everybody else, the other two, not to talk against them, but they took some time to get back and, you know, apologize, though we don't have any updated information, but okay. So we've taken their prayer card and laminated them, and I don't remember where I put them. Oh, I said, are the small ones in there?
Yeah.
Okay. If anybody would like copies of our missionary's prayer card, we will make you copies and give them to you. Hang them on your refrigerator, because I know every one of you folks is like me. You go there often. But we're Baptist. And that will give them the most exposure to each and every one of us to pray for. You'd be surprised. It doesn't take too long to begin to pray for these folks, and then God just brings it into your mind. And some of them are hours differences in time, but don't text them like I have. I texted Brother Tilly the other day. He said, "Brother, I'm 4 hours behind you." I'm sorry. All right, take your Bible tonight. Turn to Joshua chapter 2. Joshua chapter 2. And I'm going to try to be brief this evening. I have said before, I've never been to a missions conference where the pastor got to be the missionary speaker. But I have to admit, I have been enjoying it very much so. And I appreciate the opportunity to do it, and I hope the messages that I have shared have been on point, and that the Holy Ghost of God can use them in each of our lives. Joshua chapter 2 this evening. Starting verse 1, and Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out of Shechem two men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into an harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thy house, for they can come to search out all the country. And the woman took the two men and hid them, and said thus, there came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were. And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. Whither the men went, I wot not. Pursue after them quickly, for you shall overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof of the house, and hid them with the stalks of flax which she had laid in order upon the roof. And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan unto the fjords. And as soon as they which pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gate. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can be here tonight. Thank you for your word. I pray now that you help me as I take just a few minutes and bring out some things out of this text that you have spoken to my heart about. I pray that you would challenge us tonight. Lord, I pray that you do something through this week of missions conference that we can't take credit for. I pray, God, that when it comes to Commitment Sunday, that, God, we can increase our support of our current missionaries and take on many more. Lord, we know and we understand that mission is something that's near and dear to you because you've commissioned us to support it, and you have commissioned missionaries to go. Thank you that we can partner with you, men and women who can go where we cannot. Bless our time in Jesus' name. Amen. Alright, so in the first three verses we see the spies. Okay, the spies were sent to spy out the city of Jericho. When I first read that, the first thing I thought was a missionary survey trip. Missionaries often take a trip and survey the area that they're going to. I mean, if somebody tells you they're a missionary and they don't know anything about the area that they're going to, there's your first red flag. Okay? Maybe God hasn't given them a burden. Maybe they're just going to the mission field to get money. I mean, there's scams out there all over the place today. We have to be careful. The Bible tells us to try the spirits. And so if when we come in contact with missionaries, we need to test them biblically. Now, I think we've all come to the realization that the Kilgores are the real deal. I mean, you should have been here last night. We didn't even get started to Denny's last night after church, and Brother Kilgore's out there went in the neighborhood. I'm like, bless God, thank you. There's a whole bunch more out there. Go get them. It didn't quit there. After we got to Denny's, the waitress got saved.
Amen.
Four people got saved last night after church. And our waitress, Hannah, is engaged, and she's going to be moving in. I can't remember the name of the apartments, but they're over behind Starbucks. So she's literally in our neighborhood. So when I'm thinking about these spies, I'm thinking about missionaries who go out and they do the footwork ahead of time before they go to their field. Why? Because in the first part of verse 1, we see that they were sent. The Bible tells us in Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out these men secretly. Now, missionaries don't go secretly, but sometimes they have to. Brother Kilgore shared with us last night that there have been times where people have laid wait to take his life. I still remember a meeting in a certain Cracker Barrel in a certain part of Indianapolis that he invited me to go with him. I was so excited, and the longer I sat there, that old cop started raising up at me, and it's like, something is not trucking right here. And when we left, he said, well, what do you think? I said, you need to stay home. And come to find out, there was a plot in the land he was going to. And thank God he didn't go. But in our case, I believe these two spies, to me, they remind me of the missionary. They've been sent to this other land.
And the king finds out that they're there, like so many pagan kings out there today who do not like the gospel, like so many people in America. What are they trying to do? He's trying to stamp it out. He sends word to Rahab. He wants to know who the spies are, where they are, what happened to them. Why? Because he's going to get rid of them. And the devil would like to do nothing but do exactly that tonight. He wants to snuff out every Bible-believing missionary that he possibly can. So we see the spies. Then in verse 1, we also see the mission was to spy out the city. He sent them saying, go view the land. Now, if somebody tells you that they're a missionary and they've been called to a certain place and they don't have a burden for the land that they're going to, I question their call. I did. Kind of like the man that you sent. And I remember when that was going down because you and I talked about that. You know, there was a day when God had called me to be a home missionary. That's not where he has me now. But it was at that point in time, going out, going to the fairs and witnessing and winning people at the fairs. And it's a tremendous ministry. It's needed. But now, thank God, he has allowed me to the pastoral ministry. And I appreciate that. I'm thankful for it. But he has given me Walnut Street Baptist Church, and he has given Walnut Street Baptist Church to the city of Lebanon, Boone County, and Indiana. We've got a job to do. And here we are. The church has been here for a number of years. We've got a good idea of what the city looks like. Now we've got to go out and take it, if we will. So we see the spies, we see the mission, and then, thirdly, we see the mess in verses 8 to 14. Why? Because this is where things really get bad. They come, they're looking for these spies. They want to do away with them. And here we have Rahab, who is concerned for her family. I hope each and every one of us has a concern for the spiritual condition of our family. I don't know for sure, but I think my dad is going to be here tomorrow for the men's breakfast. He's going to have to leave home pretty early in the morning to be here at 8 o'clock. He lives in north of Lafayette. He's got a long way to come, but I hope he does, because I still believe he needs Jesus. And so we have here, Rahab has testified to these spies. I know we have heard what your God has done. We've heard about the parting of the Red Sea. We've heard about how God has defeated the nations. We know. And what does she do? She makes a covenant with them to protect them, to hide them in her house, to preserve their lives if they will return the favor when the nation comes in judgment, God's judgment against her people. And what do? They made that covenant. One of the last things they said to her was, as long as you keep your word, basically, we will keep our word. How did they find her? She let the spies down with a scarlet cord down the side of the wall, because she lived on the wall. And they told her, you put this scarlet thread up in your window, and we'll tell the entire army that's coming, when you see that scarlet thread in the window, you leave that window alone. Church, there's a scarlet thread that runs from Genesis to Revelation. It's called the blood of Jesus Christ. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. And so we see here this mess. I mean, this could have been really bad, because the spies told Rahab that if anybody steps outside the door of your house, they're going to be killed just like anybody else. Judgment is going to fall on them. Church, we have got to get our friends and family into the body of Christ exactly the way we have been exhorted this week, just exactly like the example that we saw last night. We've got to win our friends and family. We can't let them die and go to hell. Think about this. These men paid a high price to go. They left friends, family, home. They left everything to go to a place that was hostile. You know what? They counted the cost and they said, we're going. They trusted God for the supplies. This wasn't a caravan like we have in our day and age when our military goes out. They take everything with them. And I do mean everything. They don't lack for anything when they go. But in this day, we're talking about these two spies went out simply by faith, going to search out the city. Why? Because God was going to use the nation of Israel to judge Jericho. in this mess, there was the knowledge that judgment was coming. Rahab knew it was coming. But God was kind enough to send two missionaries that he called spies to go into this foreign land, this hostile foreign land. You might find this interesting, but when you read the lineage of Jesus, guess who you'll find?
Rahab.
God used her and placed her in the line and lineage of the Lord Jesus Christ, a person who the Bible called a harlot. He used her greatly. If he can use her, he can use me. Judgment was coming in verses 10 and 11, and this family escaped judgment. But guess what? In verses 12 to 14, salvation was coming also. This family was delivered. Anybody who went inside of Rahab's home would be spared, would be delivered from judgment. She brought in all of her family. The Bible does not record that one member of her family stepped outside the door because they knew judgment was coming. Church, every human being knows judgment is coming, but they refuse to get in the door. So because they won't come in the door, it's up to you and I to partner with our missionaries to go to places we cannot go, and it's our responsibility to go where we can to try to bring them in, like the song says that we sing. Bring them in. It is our privilege and should be our pleasure to do just exactly that. Now think about this. Some are called to go. All are called to give. I'm not called to go to Africa, but I am called to give to missions, to support missionaries to go to Africa. Just like in 9/11. Some gave all, but all gave some. The same thing with missions. It was a trite little thing, but it's the truth. You know, I know Brother Kilgore would agree with this, but we are just one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. The bread of life. Stand with me one more time. Page 541. Set my soul afire. Amen.
at one time. All right. Wow. Do you believe that song? I say, David, do you believe that song?
Amen.
People need the Lord. You know, it's not just a matter of it would be nice if they had the Lord. But the Bible says people need the Lord. All right. Somebody's going to come in and say, we have an earthquake here. The pulpit moved. Actually, we hope the pulpit will get on fire. Somebody once said, build a fire in the pulpit, people come and watch it burn. I want to head and turn to four places tonight. And Jude chapter 1, there's only one chapter, but Jude and verse number 22. Jude chapter 1, verse 22. Tonight, we're going to speak on the subject, having a heart for missions. I prepared this afternoon, and I was hopeful that the printer that I was borrowing kept saying, you're almost out of ink, you're almost out of ink. And fortunately, God worked it out, so I got it. But truly, that's one of those messages you really don't need to know. Jude chapter 1, verse 22. The Bible says, and some, notice it didn't say many, it did not say all, it did not say most, but it said, and some. And some having compassion, making a difference. I wish it would say that everybody at the Walnut Street Baptist Church had a compassion. Because if that is true, then we'd be able to say, and all at Walnut Street Baptist Church having compassion, making a difference. Yeah. I can tell you, the world needs to know that the children of God care.
Amen.
You know, we say we care, but how do we demonstrate our compassion? Go to Nehemiah chapter 1, please, and verse number 4. Nehemiah chapter 1 and verse number 4. I love the book of Nehemiah because truly, outside of Jesus, I think that you have probably the greatest act of compassion seen from a Bible character in the life of Nehemiah. In Nehemiah chapter 1, he heard a report, just like you had heard reports about the need in missions this week. You're hearing about it. Two times, you're hearing from the pastor, you're hearing from a missionary. And we're hoping that it will cause you to have a real life-changing heart for missions.
Amen.
But when Nehemiah heard the report, you know, he didn't just forget about it. He didn't just sit there and say, well, what's it to me? It's not my fault that the walls in Jerusalem are broken down. It's not my fault that the gates have been set on fire. It's not my fault that the temple of God is in disarray. It's not my fault that God is being mocked and ridiculed by the Sanballat, Tobiah, the Geshems of the world. Because he was a very rich, wealthy man that was living 1,000 miles away from Jerusalem in a place called Shushan the Palace. But when he heard the report, I want you to see the result. And before I read verse 4, I want you to listen to it. I'm giving you a report this week on global evangelism.
Amen.
I'm telling you that what she's saying is not just a beautiful song, sang beautifully as well. But the truth of that song, I can tell you, I've seen with my eyes. And soon, Bonnie is going to see outside of America with her eyes in August. And she'll come back and she'll be able to sing that song as well. Probably in a far different way than you ever would have if you'd ever sung it. She's going to say, oh my goodness, now I know what you're talking about. People need the Lord.
Amen.
So I'm sharing a report with you. People need the Lord. And I'm trying to be used of the Holy Spirit to stir up our heart of compassion again tonight. But I want us to be like Nehemiah. And more important to me, John wants us to be like Nehemiah. Amen. Because he did not forget about it. He didn't say, well, I'm glad it's them and not me. But Nehemiah noticed the result. And it came to pass when I heard these words, five things Nehemiah did. He said the first thing he did is he sat down. And I like to demonstrate this sitting down because I'm sure that he sat down. And I'm certain that he closed his eyes and began to see in his mind's eye the desolation, the brokenness. I think it began to smell the stench that came from a city filled with debris. I'm sure that he began to hear, as his eyes were closed, as he was praying and meditating and thinking about the plight of the people of God. And he could hear the taunting, hey, is your God so great? Why has he allowed the wreckage in the ruin? Hey, if your God is so powerful, why hasn't he raised up someone to go from wherever they're at to come to Jerusalem to be able to fix what is broken? And as he sat there, who knows how long? I'm sure it must have been for hours that he sat there.
No.
He sat down, and the next thing that happened was he wept. As he began to empathize and feel and identify with the people of God and the plight, it broke his heart. I want to ask you a question. When was the last time that you sat down, whether in church or whether at home, and you thought about the plight of the lost? And you began thinking about what it must be like to be lost, to be without hope, to be, I mean, those people that are in hell, that are lost now, they have no hope of ever escaping. There's no hope of parole. There's no hope of their sentence being reduced. There's no hope that the punishment will be eased over the process of millions and billions of years in the future. When was the last time that you sat down and you felt the fire of hell upon your own body? When's the last time that you thought of going to a waterless pit, and you were there, and you thought of how horrible it is to be thirsty and never to have that thirst satisfied? When was the last time that you, like Nehemiah, heard the report and it led you to do something with it, rather than just sitting in church? But it led you to say, oh dear God in heaven, what can I do to reach other people that have never heard the gospel? I think about some of the people that God's allowed us to lead to the Lord. And I'm not bragging, but in 55 months, we are just a few hundred away from seeing 27,000 people come to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In 55 months. And I thought yesterday for an extended period of time, God, what if people did not send us? What if people did not help us financially to be able to buy the plane tickets and to buy the, they call it hotels, but I can tell you, the last hotel I stayed in Uganda, there was a rat that from head to tail, it was probably that long. He went under the door because the door to the place, my room, was about that high. And then he went into the restroom. And again, that door, there was a gap about that high. And of course, I stood there and think, oh my goodness. And I'm not afraid of too much, but I'm afraid of a rat. Because they bite you and they can change your whole life in a minute.
Right.
The next night, I got in, I think about 8 o'clock at night. And that rat was running across my pillows where I was sleeping at night. So when I say hotel, when we went to Uganda or Kenya, the bordering country, and there I got bit over 75 times by mosquitoes. I did not sleep one second that night. So when I tell you about hotel, it's not like what you're probably thinking about. But nonetheless, I wanted to change your life tonight. What if we did not go because people would not give, because people would not pray, because people wouldn't say, let's see, you've got this mission trip. I wonder if they have their ticket spot times two because Bonnie's going this time, and hotel and more food, and I'm black. But what I'm saying is I'm thankful that along the way, there's people like you that say, let's do what we can so they can go and represent us. Think about that. I think about that witch doctor that just got saved, the one that I asked in a prayer letter, I think 3 months, 2 months before I went, pray for him because he's, when I get to that village, that's the first man I want to see, and sure enough, that's what we did. Now, when you think about a witch doctor, I want you to think tribal. And I want you to think this is a man that's greatly feared when he passes by. And they're demonic. But because of people that were thankful was praying, when we went there, knocked on the door, the man came out, we had small talk for a little bit, not long, and I said, do you know why I'm here? And he said, no, I did not know why an American missionary would want to come and see me. And I said, because you was in one of our Skype, which is a video conferencing services, where just like on video, well, it was live, and I thought he walked the aisle, asked for to get saved, and he thought the service was over. He came and he just started talking during the invitation. I thought he got saved, but I didn't. My heart was broken for him. And I said, we have people praying all over the world for you, and I want to tell you how you can be saved from going to hell. He said, would you let my wife come and listen to this as well? And that just completely shocked me. But that's the power of people that were praying, like Nehemiah, who heard the report, did something with it, and prayed. And we had the opportunity of leading the witch doctor to Jesus Christ, led his wife to the Lord. I preached in that village two times. That man came, and he was my guest. He sat right on the very front chair, both services.
Amen.
Then when we were going to go out and train people how to lead people to Christ, the man said, can I go with you? The witch doctor, you got saved. Well, I'm giving you reports. What if we would not have gone? Who would have reached me? All these years, who cared for this man's soul? They were afraid of him. And now he's a Christian.
Amen.
Today is what I'm trying to tell you is, I hope that I can transfer my heart for missions that I receive from God to your hearts, especially tonight. Because in a few moments, I'm going to tell you a story that I think if this does not change this church for missions even more, I mean drastically more, that I don't know what to do it. Because I know the impact of the Lord. So Nehemiah, he sat down there, he wept, he mourned certain days, which means he was grief-stricken, it was bothering him. He couldn't get the report out of his mind. And that's what I'm hoping happens from this week. I can't get away from what I've heard this week.
Amen.
I don't want this to be just another series of meetings. I want it to be life transforming.
Amen.
Transformation of all of our lives. This afternoon, Bonnie was gone. I said, God, what more can I do? God, what more would you have me to do? God, my time is short. What else can you add to my schedule that I can do to make a difference for you in the area of missions? And then he prayed. He sat down, he wept, he mourned certain days, he fasted, and he prayed before the God of heaven. He had a heart for missions. Go, if you would, please, to Matthew chapter 9, verses 36 to 38. This is Jesus having compassion. Aren't you thankful Jesus is compassionate?
Amen.
Casting all your cares upon me, he said, because I care for you. 1 Peter 5:8. Now see, Jesus says, but when he saw the multitudes, and again, 7.4 billion people living in this world right now, 7.4 million. He saw the multitudes. What impact did it have on Jesus? He was moved with compassion. Tonight, church, I'm asking you this. You've heard the report. You saw the result the report had on Nehemiah. It moved him to compassion. Jesus is looking at the multitudes, and he sees them as sheep not having a shepherd. He sees them one breath away from dying in their sins and going to hell. And the Bible says he was moved with compassion because they fainted and they were scattered abroad as sheep not having a shepherd. Then saying to his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous. You see, that's what we said. The world is waiting. They're willing. Jesus said it. He said, the harvest truly is plenteous. There's people out there by the thousands that would come to Jesus Christ if we will go. If we will go. If people like your missionary here will go and reach the children and reach the moms and reach the dads and reach the families, you'll see that they can reach ways for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Just like we can do that here in Lebanon. It can happen. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Hear a lot about the sending, don't we? Then Romans chapter 10, verse 1, brother, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that she might be saved. That's a heart of the greatest missionary of them all, the Apostle Paul. What's your heart's desire? What's your prayer to God for Lebanon? To grow the church? It's a good reason, but it's not the most important reason. Because they can come to church, hear the gospel, never get saved, walk out, and their lives will never be any different. We need to say, dear God, my prayer to you is that Lebanon might be saved.
Amen.
That's the prayer that this church needs.
Amen.
Unless you say that, well, you're just saying that about my church. No. I'm on Facebook Live. I'm aware that we're preaching to the world tonight.
Amen.
And we're talking about big cities and small cities like Manila, 16 to 20 million people. Mexico City, 25 million people. New York City, I think 5 or 6 million people. L.A., Chicago. Who knows how many people are watching and listening tonight. And what we need here in Lebanon, Indiana, is exactly what you folks out there in cyberspace needs as well. Is you need to get it on your knees and your face before God and say, God, give us our community or let me die trying. Let me die. Now, we love to emulate the great preachers of yesteryear, but if we want to have the results they have, we've got to do it the way that they did it, which is the Bible way.
Right.
And these were people of men and women of prayer.
Yes.
Did you know D.L. Moody was just sort of an average preacher? Until suddenly, he said, it was an amazing thing where one person would get saved, now 10 people were getting saved. Where 5 people would get saved, now 15 or 20 would get saved. Where 10 people might get saved, now we were seeing 100 people get saved. And here is a man who was used of God to bring 2 million people to Jesus Christ. What made the difference? 2 little old ladies. And I say it respectfully, 2 little old ladies that could not get out and knock on doors. But they began to pray for the power of God upon the life of D.L. Moody, and it transformed his entire ministry.
Amen.
R.A. Torrey, a book that I'm reading right now. R.A. Torrey was the assistant to D.L. Moody. Very scholarly man. But he was able to be used of God to go around the world, and in 2 years see over 100,000 plus people come to Jesus Christ. Do you know what it was? Or what caused it? It was some people in his church, at Moody Church, that they started a prayer meeting. And that prayer meeting was every Saturday from 10 o'clock at night to 11 o'clock. And that went on for several months. And then God began to deal with R.A. Torrey, Reuben Archer Torrey. And he began to say, God,
I sense that you're wanting me to do something else, that you're wanting us to pray more. So he got his staff together and said, let's pray after this prayer meeting from 10 to 11. Let's have our staff at the Moody Church pray from 11 to 1. And they did for several more months. And then God opened the door when he had prepared the messenger through prayer. Tens of thousands came to Jesus Christ. People that have a heart for souls. Now, having a heart for missions is synonymous with saying that I care about what matters most to Jesus Christ. Do you understand that? Having a heart for mission, that's my whole propositional statement tonight. Having a heart for missions is synonymous with saying Walnut Street Baptist Church cares about what matters most to Jesus Christ. And what matters the most to him? What matters the most to him is found in Luke 19:10. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost.
Amen.
What matters most to Jesus Christ is for people to hear what he had done for them upon the cross of Calvary, when he who knew no sin became sin for them, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him, 2 Corinthians 5:21. His greatest desire is for every single person around the world, all 7.4 billion individuals, to hear the gospel. Now, I believe that we are living in the generation where we can make that happen.
Amen.
Now, we can't save them. That's the business of the Holy Spirit. The way salvation works is Jesus Christ paid the penalty for our sin, shed his blood. It is finished, he said. He died, he rose again. It's the gospel is recorded in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. And it's our responsibility, so the Holy Spirit will take what Jesus did, and as the soul winner, which is you and I, or the preacher, as we're preaching the Word of God, he will take the truth of the Word of God and will produce the conviction in the lives of every unsaved person to convince them that what we are saying from the Word of God is the absolute, infallible truth of the Word of God. And then God has given to every person this freedom of choice where they can choose, what will I do with Jesus Christ? You cannot be neutral with him. John 1:11, Jesus said, you have the opportunity to reject me. He came into his own, and his own what? Receiving none. So you see him over Jerusalem in Matthew chapter 9. You see the brokenness, the compassion, because he knows that they most have rejected what he was going to do for them. Mark verse 12. John 1:12. We can make the choice to receive Jesus Christ by faith. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Paul believed this. Paul believed it, and it changed his life.
Amen.
His life was dedicated to stopping out the spread of Christianity before he got saved. That's why he went in Acts chapter 7, and chapter 7, he's standing there watching Stephen being stoned, and he's consenting, which means he's very pleased. You go to chapter 8, and you go through chapter 9, and you'll find that there are over 20-some different words used to describe what Paul did against the church. He was all in. Let's destroy it. Let's wipe it out. Let's put an end to this cult called Christianity. But when he got saved in Acts 9:6, he said, Lord, what will thou have me to do? And that's what the church is being asked to ask of yourselves tonight, Lord, what would you have us to do by way of faith promise missionary giving? Lay it on my heart. Let me know. Let my family know. What is it that we can trust you for that's beyond our ability? But to know that the heart of God is in missions and in winning people to Jesus Christ, evangelization of the world. Do you really believe what you say that you believe? I'm going to challenge us all. Us. Do you really believe the Bible is an inerrant, infallible word of God? Would you talk to me tonight? Yes or no?
Yes.
Do you believe everything that God says in the Word of God is a fact and is truthful?
Yes.
Now, do you really believe that? We believe it in our head, but do we believe it with our hearts? My question to you is, do we really, and I'm going to make it personal, do you really believe what you say you believe the Bible teaches about those that are lost? Do you really believe it? If you and I really believe it, what difference is it making in our lives? What difference is it making in this church? What difference is it making in what we're communicating to the young people in this church? Or to the adults of the church? Recently, I listened to an audio book on the life of a great missionary, a missionary to Africa. This man so loved the African people and it was a reciprocal love. They loved him because they saw the genuineness of this man. He was not a man that came to preach to them or preach at them. He was a man that conveyed the heart of God from that could reach his heart, and he spoke in a way that reached the heart of these tribal people. But on May 1st, 1873, at 4 a.m., David Livingston went to be with the Lord under the age of 30. The people of Africa were grief-stricken. They loved him. They loved him a lot. They said, can we have the body of this missionary? We want to bury the body here in Africa. And the request was denied. No, we're bringing it back home. Then will you let us cut out his heart and bury his heart in Africa? Because everybody knows his heart is in Africa and his heart needs to stay here.
Amen.
And that request was granted and they buried the heart of David Livingston. Does the people in London, Indiana know what is in your heart?
Hey.
Do they know how deeply you care about their lostness?
Right.
Their eternality? The words I'm about to say now, I hope, will pierce deep into your heart. David Livingston, when he arrived, as a young man, he went before the tribal chief and he set up a meeting. And as was the custom, that when you had a new person coming before the tribal chief, they could have a Q&A time, a time of question and answer. And David Livingston had prepared this nice message. He was going to preach to them about the love of God. And that would have been great, wouldn't it? Because they need to know that Jesus loves them.
Amen.
In spite of their poverty, Jesus still loves you. He still cares about you. And he cares so much. And of course he could go into the gospel. But the tribal chief said, I have a topic I want you to teach me on. And Missionary Livingston said, oh, what is that? He said, talk to us about the judgment of God. Interesting, isn't it? Tell us about the future judgment that's awaiting us when we die. I want you to think about this for a moment. When's the last time we talked to lost people about the fact that one day they're going to face God?